it and how it evolved into what it is today, and a few basics of what blended learning is. So that was some kind of an introduction to what we plan to do during the rest of the 4 days. Okay, let's move on from there. But before that, I would like to just check how sure you are. Okay, once again, right. I think there is again another problem. Okay, that's okay. We'll leave that. Let's move from here. So let's see some tools and techniques that are useful to us in handling this blended learning. This is just a statistical figure. I don't want to spend much time because we have lost time already. Almost every child in the entire world is affected because of the pandemic. That's, I mean, a known fact. Not only in India, the whole world. Maybe about 100% of the student population has been affected, and regular classes have not been possible for several months. So we need to think of something that suited the situation. And one of the alternatives that was available to us was virtual learning. And luckily for us, right at the time when the lockdown started, virtual learning was already quite popular. Many universities, many countries had already switched over to virtual learning platforms even before the lockdown had started. In fact, blended learning or virtual learning or whatever other names that it has, e-learning, they were all knocking at the door. They were right to enter any moment. If the lockdown had not happened, if the pandemic had not happened, still in the next few months, anyway, we were going to have this very popularly spreading, wide and fast spreading blended learning. So that's here. When I go to colleges and talk to teachers, typically teachers ask me a question, sir, because virtual learning has become so popular, because it's going to be some new technologies available, because some robots are going to teach soon instead of human beings, will teachers be completely irrelevant? Will teachers no longer be necessary? This is a question that often they ask. Now, the answer is very simple. The answer is no time in the future, right? Never in the history of mankind, a teacher will be completely irrelevant. Teachers will surely be needed, whatever be the kind of development that's going to happen. But what we must keep in mind is that in case we don't update ourselves, in case we don't learn the new technologies, in case we don't, continuously learn as students instead of as teachers. So if we are not lifelong learners, there is a possibility of somebody who knows the technology replacing us. Some younger, more knowledgeable, more technically skilled, more tech savvy individual will come and replace us because we are making ourselves obsolete. So a teacher's position does not become obsolete, but a teacher who does not update himself or herself may become irrelevant. So there is a great responsibility on the part of every teacher, however old he or she is, whatever be the kind of skills that he or she already has, there is an urgent need for us to update ourselves. And one more thing, if we teach today's students the way we always have been teaching, the same traditional ways, so the same chalk and duster method, the same lecture method, suppose we continue teaching the same way we have been doing it all these years, we will rob them of our future. We are going to be some kind of criminals. Every teacher is going to be some kind of a criminal if the new technologies are not used, if new skills are not taught, if new knowledge is not given, and if new methods are not used. Because it's the future of a generation that's in our hands. So every teacher has this responsibility to update oneself. Right. So this is what blended learning is. I gave you an idea of what it is yesterday, but maybe I'll give you a few more details today. Right. So this is what you perhaps have been very familiar with. Your teachers use this. Maybe your teachers used it, and most teachers even today, perhaps unfortunately, are using this. This is the physical classroom. As it is, it's good, but it has, of course, some inherent deficiencies for which, of course, we've been thinking of alternatives, but it has its own advantages. The physical classroom has many advantages like personalization of education. So the student teacher are constantly in contact with one another, and there is a great opportunity for every one of them to learn directly from the teacher, right, from the horse's mouth. And motivation is possible, right, because the eye contact is there, because the body contact is there, because the physical presence is there, because the teacher sometimes gives a pat, and because the teacher motivates. So, because motivation works a lot more than anything else. Feedback, instant feedback is possible in a physical classroom, and lots of other factors, relevance, discipline, soft skills, peer learning, all these are possible in a physical classroom. But look at something else. On the other side, the second format, the second platform that already has become very popular, both with teachers and students, and many colleges and universities have already switched over to virtual platforms. The virtual platform brings with it lots of other advantages. If advantages were not there, perhaps it would not become so very popular. Very, very popular, mighty and eminent universities all over the world have switched over to virtual platforms. If virtual platforms did not have any advantages, if physical brick and mortar classrooms were the ideal choice, they would not have switched over to that. I think very big universities, eminent universities like MIT switched over to virtual platforms long, long, long ago. So virtual platforms also offer some advantages. Mobility, for instance, the student can move about, and then wherever the student is, learning is possible. It need not be confined to the four walls of a classroom. The structure also can be manipulated very conveniently, the structure of the class. For instance, in a physical classroom, the teacher follows a certain structure. One comes before two, two comes before three. But in the case of virtual platforms, three can come first and one can later. If a student has, he is interested that way. He has control to manipulate things the way he wants. He can structure his learning. The teacher can track the learning that's happening very easily. It's possible in physical class also, but in virtual classes and in blended learning classes, it's much easier. And economy, I don't need to tell you about that. Self-study is possible. Global reach is possible. If I have a good teacher, I can reach a much larger number of students. The best teachers are available to all the students, unlike in the past, unlike in the physical classrooms. So in case there is a good university, if there is a highly reputed college with great teachers there, automatically the spread is much larger. So the best teachers are available to everybody. This is, I think, some kind of a socialistic pattern. So the human capital and the technology both come together to become blended learning. Blended learning can be two different kinds in another fashion. In the previous slide, I told you blended learning is bringing the physical classroom and the virtual classroom together, combining them. Part of this and part of this. Only virtual education is not blended learning. Only physical learning is not blended learning. A combination of both. A combination, what does that combination mean? How much of this, how much of this? We'll go into those details when we discuss the tools available, and also the other factors that go into deciding that. So a second level at which blending happens is the synchronous and the asynchronous. There are two ways of teaching students. For instance, there are about 75 of you now listening to me. All of you are listening to me at the same time. I am teaching from my place, and you're all listening to me from your places. So the physical place is not the same, but the time is the same. I'm teaching and you are listening to me. So this is called synchronous. If you were in a physical classroom and if I had come to your college and had addressed you in a standard format of a seminar, workshop, whatever, that also would have been synchronous, but the place also would be the same. So synchronous can be same place and same time, or same time, but different places, like now. That is one level. And on the other level, learning can happen asynchronously also. Some of you might have produced beautiful video lessons. And when you posted those video lessons on YouTube, or maybe any other platform, or maybe you just sent them to your students, the student perhaps is not listening to that lesson at the same time that you wanted him to. Perhaps you sent the lesson to them, and like the assignment that I sent you in the morning, every one of you answered it at a different time. So that was a textual assignment that I created and sent it to you. And some of you, not all, of course, maybe a slightly more number than yesterday. So you responded to that. I was very happy with the responses. Some of the responses are really good. So those responses you gave at different times. That is called asynchronous. Now, when we talk about blended learning, we talk about blending this also. So part of the learning happens synchronously, and part of the learning happens asynchronously. That means a part of the syllabus, curriculum, learning, education, whatever, happens when the teacher is teaching and the students are directly sitting in front or maybe sitting away and listening to the teacher and learning is happening. And a part of the curriculum, some course, some part of the course, some components of the course, right, happen asynchronously. So the teacher teaches and the students have freedom to choose to listen whenever they want. So a little of this, a little of this, part of this together becomes blended learning. So the two levels are combining the physical with the virtual and combining the synchronous with the asynchronous. These two things you must keep in mind when you think of blended learning. I have taken so much time to explain this to you because many people mistake virtual learning for blended learning. Just because it's happening online, they think it's blended learning. No. Virtual learning is one kind of learning, using technology to teach from a distance, using tools, techniques, whatever. Now, combining both. So unless a part of the education, unless the student has access to the, it need not be the same kind of access that the physical classroom allows. Sometimes, even if it's online, the student has direct access to the teacher to interact personally, one-on-one. So that kind of an opportunity must be there. And reaching a larger number of people at the same time also is there. So multiple kinds of blending. In fact, if you go back into history, even when you were a student, maybe 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, if the teacher gave you a little homework after he or she taught you whatever she taught you in the class, that also some kind of blessing, blending. So part of the lesson was happening in the class and part of the learning was happening at home through homework. So, I mean, this is a very complex thing. So lots of kinds of things can go into various forms, various formats, and they can merge to become blended learning. But today, in today's context, most blended learning is physical, partly virtual, and partly synchronous and partly asynchronous. So the best of both worlds. The greatest advantage of this is the best of both the worlds. Best of this, best of that. Okay. I'll just quickly show you once again. They're long videos, but I wanted to show them longer, but maybe I'll show you 1 minute of each. And you have to tell me the differences between the two. This is a video that was made about 10 years ago. I don't know. I think it's playing now. Yeah, please wait for a moment. Yeah.
Of face each other and they discuss, they talk to each other. That's one easy. For instance, let's demonstrate this. All four of you please turn that side. Four
is it audible to you?
One second. Yes, please.
Hello, can you hear the audio? Anyone?
Sir, this is Murli, Government Degree College from Jamal Madugu.
Mr. Murli, yes.
Actually, my question is, if the students are not showing interest and if the students are not willing to participate in group work and pair work, how can we manage, how can we control, how can we motivate those students in that situation, what we need to do exactly?
To answer you, you have to first answer my question. Why
okay,
are they
I'll
not interested?
Stop it here. I'll play a second video.
We should be appropriate and we should actually make the students.
This is some kind of a regular Zoom class.
What is to be done
which
in
happened
the class.
Very recently. Thank you, Intias. Thank you so much. Yeah, so collaborative tools is, I mean, there are maybe. Okay, will somebody tell me if I'm still audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So I showed you two videos, a very short, maybe 1 minute clips of each. So what's the difference? The first one happened a decade ago when I was invited to give an online, it was called online at that time. It was online TV lesson. Why was it called online then? Because when I made a presentation to English lecturers, quite senior English lecturers, you might have seen them in the studio there. So some senior English lecturers were seated inside a TV studio and I made a presentation to them. While I was making that presentation, it was aired live and some teachers maybe from their hometowns, from degree colleges all over Andhra Pradesh and Telangana those days. So they were asking me questions in between. So it was online for two reasons. One, it was being aired live, and two, there was a possibility of lecturers who were listening from a distance interacting with me on phone. They could ask me a question. But look at what happened. This was about a month ago. The second video that I showed you is a month ago. That's exactly like what's happening now. It was just a Zoom class. So students were directly seeing me as I made the presentation and they were interacting with me. And there was possibility of questions, all kinds of things. It was almost like a physical class. So within a matter of a decade, technology has made it so very different, the interpretation of what's online, what's blending. So could we call the one that you saw earlier, the TV lesson, could that be called a blended lesson? Those days it was not. It was not, I mean, the blended learning was not a term that was not popular yet, but that was some kind of blending because it was happening, though the whole thing was happening synchronously, there was possibility of people interacting from a distance, right? And also the same TV lesson was available in a recorded format for teachers and colleges to replay and learn. So this is the, I mean, the change because of the times. Okay, let's move on to the next important decision that we need to take about this. In case we decide to blend, I made a mention of this a little earlier. In case we decide to make a blend of synchronous and asynchronous, physical and virtual, what variables decide the right blend? How do we decide which is the right way? What decides? Can anybody go to the chat box and tell me what factors, what variables decide the right kind of blend? I'm waiting for some responses from you. What factors decide how to blend? Can the teacher blend two things any way she likes? For instance, I asked my students to come on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday to college and interact with me, and Friday, Thursday, Saturday, whatever, I ask them to stay at home and then I give a virtual lesson. Does that become blending or is there any other factor that decides it? I don't see any responses coming in yet. I think it has begun. Yeah, I think Raman says adoptable. Okay. Right. Some more answers, please, before I show you my own answers. Flexibility, correct, right? Sridhar says flexibility. And Raman says acceptability. Maybe acceptability, what you mean is the teachers, the students, the systems. And Ajay Kumar says variable. It must be variable. Okay. A variety. Right. I agree. And it must be student-centric. Both the places. Yes. Even if it's not blended, it must still be student-centric. That's a modern concept. And then everybody believes that education must be student-centric. Nasir says, thank you, sir. Sai Kishore says, student-centric. Shailaja says, making interactive and some fun activities. Yes. Again, fun activities. Interaction must be there in both the physical format, in the virtual format, in the blended format. My question is, what decides how to blend network facility and students? There are some issues relating to this. Yes. Okay. Competency of the teacher. Yeah, that's a good suggestion. It depends on the competency of the teacher. Subha says interactive sessions and Subrata says technology. Maybe what you mean is that availability of technology. Yes, that's an important factor. If the technology is not available, perhaps blending also may become impossible. Okay, thank you. Not many answers are forthcoming. I'll leave here and then maybe I'll move on. So there are lots of different factors that help us decide how to blend. Right? What are they? The first and the most important thing is the objectives of the course. What is it that you want to achieve by teaching the course that you are teaching? In case the objectives of the course demand some kind of blending, do it. Otherwise, not necessary. Just because blending is available, don't do it. Suppose in a classroom, there is a duster, there is a blackboard, there is a crayon, or there is a chalk piece or whatever. You don't use them just because they are there. So you use them when you need them. Suppose you have a PowerPoint slideshow, you use it only when it's essential. Suppose you have some technical tool available in your laboratory. So you use it when it's essential. Similarly, you have to decide. You means the whole system. When I say you, I mean a lot of people behind you. So the course designers, the policy makers, the curriculum makers, the materials producers, the textbook producers, right, the classroom teacher. And maybe if there is a pressure group, a public policy, and sometimes if your college is autonomous, your management. So many other factors go into it. So all of you together decide what kind of, how much of blending is necessary. How much of virtual learning is essential? How much of physical learning is essential? So maybe government policies also. Sometimes, for instance, there is a student who has been admitted to a certain college which does not allow absenteeism and attendance. 100% attendance is absolutely essential to get through a course. So everything must happen inside the class only. So blending, this kind of blending, I mean, maybe other kinds of blending are possible, but virtual learning, there is no scope there. So objectives of the course are one factor, one very important factor that decide how much to blend, how to blend. Course content. All subjects may not lend themselves to blending. There are some subjects which make it very easy and convenient, right? And there are some subjects perhaps where blending may not be necessary or may not be possible. Take a simple example. Suppose I am teaching music. In case I want to teach an instrument, how to play a guitar. Suppose I want to teach somebody. Maybe, I mean, blending is possible only in some ways. Some lessons can be given online and the student can receive those lessons and maybe I can play or I can video myself playing the guitar and then I can send it to him and seeing that, maybe he can practice. But there are some lessons that must be taught in physical presence. Maybe I have to handhold them in some cases, right? I have to correct them. Unless the student is physically in my presence, it may not be possible. I gave you and maybe an example that's very easy for you to follow, but in your own subjects, maybe there are some components. Suppose you are teaching a management subject. You have to think, right? If you are a policymaker, you have a greater responsibility. Even if you are a classroom teacher and nothing more than that, still you have the responsibility to decide which components can be offered virtually, which components can be offered physically. So the course content decides that. And most importantly, some of you gave answers in the chat box already. Learner profiles. What kind of students do you have? What are their needs? What are their earlier competence? How skilled are they already? How many of them have mobile phones? How many of them have technology, access to technology? Suppose none of your students are, maybe most of your students do not have technological tools or maybe mobile phones, smartphones, or maybe Wi-Fi at home. You are working in a rural area where even power perhaps is not like it was a problem today. Suppose there is a problem like that. Maybe virtual learning may not be possible at all. So you have to take all those considerations into account before you decide how much of what to blend. So learner styles, you have a lot of students who love learning by seeing things. Maybe visual appeal is what's essential. Maybe even if you are in a physical classroom, maybe you have to do a little drama. Maybe you have to use the blackboard. Maybe you have to use a PowerPoint slideshow. Maybe you have to take them to the laboratory and show them. And in case virtual learning is possible, of course, sky is the limit. Right. Then student attitudes, the location where you are. Just now I told you. So where you are working also decides how and how much to blend. Teacher competence, somebody I think said it right in the chat earlier. So teacher competence, how competent the teacher is. If the teacher does not know how to blend, if the teacher does not know how to use technology, how to use a tool that's available, I think there's no point in doing it. If the teacher is forced to do that, maybe it will be a fail, it will be a flop. So first, I mean, this is something not related to the topic today, but I would like to tell you at this time, but every time a new technology is introduced, every time a change is made, every time a new policy comes into force, the first thing that must happen is teacher training. But unfortunately, that does not happen. I don't know about other countries, but at least in India, things are just decided all of a sudden and they are thrust on teachers. Most teachers are, I mean, taken all by surprise, unawares. So if I am asked to do something which I myself am not very well equipped with, I think it will be a disaster. Handling something incompetently can be a disaster, right? So if you give a technology to somebody who does not know how to handle that, what happens? He'll meddle with that and then something will go wrong and then the whole thing can fail. See, even a big city like Hyderabad, of course, there is a cyclone here and then there was no power for almost 5 hours, right? Everything was disrupted and even my backup failed for 2.5-3 hours. It lasts beyond that? No. So if this kind of, problems can arise even in big cities with the technology available, you can imagine what happens outside in smaller rural areas, interior. So the location also needs to be taken into account. So maybe the government must have lots of different kinds of policies with regard to blending. In city colleges, perhaps the need is different, and maybe in rural colleges, the need is different. Teacher competencies have to be developed. The government has this responsibility, a very important responsibility to equip teachers with the necessary tools. In fact, I always have been pleading, even I spoke to the UGC also on one or two occasions, saying that every teacher who is appointed in a college must first undergo a 1 or 2 years of training, then only they must be allowed to enter a class, like it happens at school level. School level, they have something called B.Ed. So a B.Ed is a minimum degree that they are expected to have before they become teachers. But at the college level, unfortunately, again, I'm talking about India, I don't know about others. So at least in India, what happens is somebody who is a postgraduate or somebody who is a PhD has nothing to do with your teaching skills. PhD is something relating to your wisdom, your knowledge, your ability to probe into something, your ability to discover something, right? So that's a different area, not teaching skill. Government makes PhD compulsory, but not a course like B.Ed compulsory. That's again a very silly paradox. Okay, so he just have to be competent. Right? If they are competent, if they are equipped, if they are taught the skills before they are made compulsory, I mean, learning becomes effective in the classroom. So teacher competence is another area that needs to be considered when we decide what is the right blend. And availability of resources. I think you already said that. I also told you yesterday, told you today. And availability of resources. Without that, in the olden days, I mean, teachers used to complain textbooks are not there. Today, maybe we complain or students do not have smartphones with them. So how does online learning happen? So resources also. Yesterday, somebody was asking me that question towards the end of the class. Sir, students do not have this technology available to them, the tools available to them. So this is something, again, we lift our hands up in despair because we can't do anything. We have, I mean, limited control over that kind of things. So as a classroom teacher, if you have freedom to blend synchronous and asynchronous, physical and virtual, keep all these things in mind. Right? You empower yourself and think on behalf of the students. Think on behalf of yourself. Decide what is an ideal combination of the two parallels. I think I've made it clear to you. So blending is and something that happens with a lot of care, a lot of thought. So there are three factors that decide that the learning environment has to be elastic, the media that you use, the medium or the technology, etc., the methodology. All these three things go into deciding how it is, right? So coming to the platforms that are available, the popular tools that are available to us, we'll spend some 5-10 minutes on this and then maybe we'll close at 7:30 as planned. And perhaps we'll continue tomorrow. So these are a few popular tools and platforms. So there is a whole lot of mobile apps available today. Apps readily available, easy to use, very convenient, and most of them are free. And maybe till tomorrow, because you have some time, by the time we meet again tomorrow, you can try the first one that I've shown there, Hello English, because it's useful to all of you, whatever subject you teach. Maybe you are a management teacher, but still improving your own English language skills is absolutely essential. Hello English is a mobile app. Most parts of it, of course, there is a paid version also, but the free version is enough for us. So you can download it today. And maybe you can try it tonight. And tomorrow when you come, you can tell me some of your experiences with that. How it is structured, how it is designed, etc. How it can be used for blending your learning. Right. Then there are virtual classroom platforms like Google Classroom. We tried it yesterday. And others also like Edmodo. I'll come to some of them in the course of my future presentations. Then there are video streaming technologies available like Katura, like Diecast, etc. Like YouTube itself is one. I don't know if this is being live cast on YouTube, the same lesson now. I don't know. So then video conferencing tools are there. Zoom, what we are using now. So right now we are on Zoom. Zoom is a conferencing tool. Zoom has a meeting. Zoom has a webinar, two channels. Zoom meeting, Zoom webinar. Go to meeting, go to webinar. Most of them have two formats with different advantages. I'll not go into them now. So Google Hangouts, Citrix, et cetera, et cetera. Some of these are various video conferencing tools. So a teacher has to be familiar with these tools that are available to her. What tools are absolutely essential for the teacher as well as for the student to make blending possible, to make learning effective. Once you decide what tool is most appropriate to you, after a little research, maybe you equip yourself with that skill and you also educate your students in using that skill. Suppose you are absolutely competent in using a certain technology or tool, but your students are not familiar with that. Again, it leads to some kind of a disaster. Let that not happen. So what you do is, first, educate yourself. If the government has not done it, if your management has not done it, luckily for you, there are so many programs like this happening right now. I think there are too many, rather. In the last 6 months, I think every one of you might have heard a bundle of certificates, right? A bunch of them. And quite a lot of certificates have been given after you attended those programs. So this was a wonderful opportunity for you to update yourself. But this does not stop there. You need to equip your students also, no? So suppose you know something and your students do not know. Suppose I use some tool today and you are not familiar with that tool. It's useless. Right? So do both the things. Right. Actually, if I had time, I wanted to try one of these things today. But maybe what we'll do is I'll stop here and I'll take some of your questions so that it'll be easier for us to continue here, continue from here. Somebody has written, Grammarly is good for written English. Yes, Grammarly is a tool that helps you edit what you do on your screen. It's constantly in the background. It helps you check your spelling. It helps you grammar and a lot of other things. But luckily for you, I mean, most of the other things like even your Word, your PowerPoint, all those things come equipped with auto spell checker, etc., etc. Somebody says, Sridhar says, I'm already using Hello English. It's a very good app to learn spoken English. Yes, that's good. Yeah, it's a really good app. I've been using it for nearly 2 years. I've recommended it to many, many students of mine. Shubrat says, it's an eye-opening session, very knowledgeable session. Yes. Okay, thank you very much. Thanks a lot. If you have any questions, you can raise your hand or you can type your question in the chat box. Maybe for the benefit of those who came late, I would like to tell you there was a power disruption in my area. There was a Wi-Fi failure. I could not sit in the dark and then I could not talk to you. It was not possible. My backup also lasted only 2 to 3 hours, and then by about 5:30 it failed completely. That's why the class did not start on time. Let's hope similar problems will not occur again. There don't seem to be any questions. Mr. Malaysia, are there any questions?
If there is no questions, today's link I'm sharing, sir, feedback attendance.
You can post the feedback
In the chat. Everyone, please. Yeah.
So it's being posted in the chat box. The feedback format is already there. So
Team 740, the link will be open. Please fill all the numbers.
Right. Thank you, Suma. Thank you for your words of appreciation. So a few other participants have somebody says, Hari Prasad Soma says, classroom live session cannot be compensated. That's what I told you, actually. Everyone has some advantages. The classroom has as many advantages as a virtual classroom has. The physical classroom and the virtual classroom, they don't substitute each other. They compensate and complement each other. Both are complements. Don't say, this is the best. No, this is best. This is also the best. Both are good. So what is good here and what is good here? We take both of them, put them together, take the golden mean. There is something called a golden mean via media. Something. In fact, almost all technologies have developed like that. Two extremes are brought together. The golden mean is identified and we go along. That's how new technologies often arise. Synthesis. So if you still believe that classrooms are the best and virtual platforms do not have any advantages, please wipe that away, right? I mean, don't think that one of the two has all the advantages and the other does not have any advantages at all.